Black Swamp Radio, the only paranormal radio station with a frog in a blender.
There's a touch of madness around here.
Dark, damp, stench-infested laboratory that smells from the decomposing bodies of tweakers and crackheads that were used during the experimentation for alien research. In an old, ghostly, haunted, abandoned dwelling with ghosts and specters of all ages, somewhere in the alien-infested Black Swamp of Northwest Ohio, this is Black Swamp Radio Live, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp.
Well, stupid guy was already.
Well, hello there, guys. Thanks for tuning in on a Thanksgiving out of the Black Swamp in Northwest Ohio. I am doing a live show tonight. It's been one of those days. Tomorrow's Thanksgiving. I hope everybody has a good Thanksgiving. I hope that it goes smoothly and well, and that there's no fighting with the in-laws and so on and so forth. You know, my day is like, I had to call the cable company because my internet is screwing up, just so you know that right up front. And they're going to send somebody out tomorrow, believe it or not. So, with that being said, you can always listen to us from Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live, and we also have our listening line from TalkStream Live as well, and I give the shout out to Angel on PSN, and we've got our affiliates page, which is now filled to the brink, man. There's like 30 different links there, but the most important one I'm going to tell you about is to go get your Shoutcast server if you want to do the cool DJ thing that I do. It's for a really good price. So anyhow, we're also on TuneIn, and the podcast for our shows is on TuneIn as well. Anyway, without further ado, I bring you Ghost Magnets with a Twist. These people are out of New York State, and they've got some pretty interesting stuff going on, man. Hello, and welcome to the show.
Hi, Arizona. This is Red.
Hi, Red.
Arizona. This is Twist, the one and only.
Twist. Yeah, Red and Twist. They do have real names.
Well, for those who'd like to know, we're Tom and Jonna Kelly, and we're in the beautiful Hudson Valley.
That's for sure.
I have been invited up there so many times. I need to come up there and see what it looks like, because I hear it's gorgeous. And I hear Bigfoot likes to stay up there. So
you need to see the beautiful mountains and the Hudson River. It's a lush, green, beautiful spot.
Yeah, I need to do that. And I also need to ask you, first off, tell us where we can find you at, your websites, and how to get in touch with you, and all that.
If you go to our Facebook page, Ghost Magnets with a Twist, it can hook you up with our website. It's a really popular Facebook page. We've got over 29,000 followers, and then we do another page, which is an editor's page called Paranormal Enthusiasts of Dutchess County. Got another 9,000 people on there for a total of about 38,000 followers, which is really neat, because we interact with followers, and we do a question of the day, and we share our experiences and places that we've been.
It sounds like a lot of fun. I want to thank Donna.
I want to thank Donna for doing a really great job on the site. She's our editor.
Well, thank you.
Cool.
There's a rare compliment.
Is it?
And yeah, it begins. It's definitely rare. I don't give compliments to my teammates and all of it all.
Well,
very rare.
We've been together for a long time, so we've developed our ways of interacting with each other. And we don't always agree. That keeps it interesting.
Yeah, but you don't kill each other, so there's something said about that.
Well, yeah, sometimes we do. It depends on the investigation.
Exactly.
So, are you guys going to be having Thanksgiving dinner at home, or do you got plans for Thanksgiving, or what's going on?
Go ahead, Jonna.
Well, this holiday, we traditionally go over to our son's house, and he and our daughter-in-law do the cooking. So we just were tasked with bringing some pastry, some chips and dips, so we got off the hook. That's why we're on the phone right now. Otherwise, I'd be busy in the kitchen.
Oh, you're not totally off the hook. I bet you're going to have to do dishes.
Well, that's usually an interesting part where you get to do a little gossiping as well.
Yeah, you heard my things. I get to stay here and wait for the cable guy. We're not doing a damn thing tomorrow. We were invited to go to Kelly's daughter's, but I don't think we're going to do that. But then again, you know, she's the one that says, okay, we're going here, we're going there. So I have to follow like the good little puppy that I am.
Did you hear that, Twist?
Oh.
I'm sorry, I was sleeping.
Oh, okay.
You got to nudge me a little bit.
Okay. So what kind of paranormal investigators are you?
Ghost hunters?
Well, they call him Twist for a reason. He's not so quick to call everything a ghost, and he started out as a real skeptic, and as time went on, began to see that, you know, there were things out there that we couldn't explain.
Mm, yeah.
So our team is pretty well balanced. We have those that are great debunkers. We have an artist who does sketching. We actually have a former funeral director on the team. We've got a number of school employees that are used to working with people, know how to do a good interview. It's a pretty well-balanced team. We've got our tech guy. We have our gal that does the EVP analysis. So it's well-rounded.
We've got two EVP analyses, so we'll recognize the other person.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
We got two.
You've got a mortician on the scene. Is that so that you can hide the body easier? You got somebody to tell you exactly what to do?
Well, he knows what to expect from the dead.
Yeah, that's funny, man. Yeah, I like that. Oh, yeah. What happens is if we get a ghost that hasn't been embalmed, he takes care of that.
Yeah. That works.
Yeah. Oh, God, that's too funny.
We also have started something here in the Hudson Valley, and that is we do once a month a meetup, and it's for people that are interested in the paranormal and maybe don't have many people that they can talk to about it. You know, family and friends are not always so accepting of these ideas. So they can get together with other like-minded people once a month. We meet at a local diner. They give us the private room, and we can offer it for free. All they do is come and order a refreshment of some kind. And we have great speakers. We've had Linda Zimmerman, who came and spoke with us.
We've had her on the show.
I know.
Yeah.
She's phenomenal.
This is the speaker.
Got great stories, and they're so entertaining. We had John Zaffis. He drew about 80 people that night. And then we had Brian Kano, who used to work with him on Haunted Collector. We've had Alexandra Holzer, Hans Holzer's daughter, Krista Cesare. We have different topics, like we've talked about crystals and healing energy, Reiki. Upcoming, we have John Tobin from Glory Haunt Hounds. So it's interesting, as well as being able to exchange ideas. People hear new ideas.
I also want to thank John for doing a really great job of keeping this meetups together, and also the Hudson Valley people that come out and hear our stories. And we got a very big crowd that actually are coming a little by little. And, you know, to tell you the truth, we're going to have like a regular 100 people just on a regular night. So, I mean, to be honest with you, I want to thank John for that.
Oh, thank you. We it's a collaborative effort, and we started off with maybe just a handful of people, and it's just grown because people will tell others that, you know, it's a nice night out. It really doesn't cost anything,
You
get to see and hear some of these para celebrities that when you go to a paracon are going to cost you money to see.
Pay for it.
Yeah,
we've been very lucky. Blessed.
We're lucky. We're blessed with that. But they're nice people, you know, because it works for them, too, because when they do events, they go to him, his events. So it works both ways. It works with the other hands.
Right.
That's how it works in this business.
Yeah, and that's very true. So on a typical night, how's your investigation go?
How does our investigation go? Very good. I mean, we do very interesting investigations. I always... go to the top.
My question was basically, okay, what do you take with you? You know, what's your instruments that you use?
And
equipment. And all that kind of happy.
We all got the whistles and bells, rim pods, K2s. Now we're using echo boxes, portals, things of that nature.
We've got a lot of equipment, and Twist keeps collecting more and more of it as we go along. What is a portal?
Count on that. A portal?
Yeah.
That's like a radio, a Huff paranormal designed it, and it's like a radio, and it interacts with the spirits, and they talk through the radio.
It actually takes out the white noise.
The white noise also.
From, you connect it either to a spirit box, to an echo box, and it has a reverb on it, and it sounds as though you're hearing the voices through a tunnel.
Yeah, it's like a wah-wah sound.
Yeah, it just clears it up so that you can hear the word bank that's produced better than you would without putting it through this portal device.
Yeah, it's an okay device now, but now echo boxes are very popular now. It's easy. Well, what it is, it's easy. You plug it in to a speaker amplifier, and it does the same thing. And to tell you the truth, their rebarbs are phenomenal. The design that they have out there is phenomenal. But, you know, it's just an easy tool. You get it, boom. You don't have to twiggle the instruments while you're doing that. On the Huff paranormal stuff that he did, you have to tweak it. You don't have to tweak this. You just have to run it and just talk it and let the spirits do their job. So I think that device. And, you know, they're designing each individual designs every year. You know, something different. Something pops better than this. You know. Whatever.
I had never heard of that portal before, so thank you for clarifying.
Yeah, it's very good. It's very good. I've gotten really good responses out of that. We had very good responses in my last investigation, which I'll talk about it when we want to talk about our investigations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think we cut off Red. Go ahead, Red.
Oh, I did? Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, we started off for our first 9 years trying to find answers for ourselves. We worked with some other teams and really learned about what it was we wanted to do before we did it. And now, in this past year, we've been opening our investigations up to the general public. And we invite them along, and now we really feel as though we're trying to educate people to learn what we have in terms of how to investigate proper techniques and methods. You know, everybody likes to use different ways. Some are old school and just want to stick to a recorder and a camera. Others are more interested in the technology end of it. But, you know, we feel as though we're kind of doing a service now to help others to learn about the paranormal.
Well, we also want to seek experience in ghosts, too. So it's both.
Okay, so from what I understand, from what Al has told me, you guys have got some... Oh, I have a question for Al. I'm going to go to the question first, and I'll say what I was going to say. He says, to ask you about the John Storm house, which is basically where I was going to start going anyway.
Oh, you're going to John Storm house first? Okay.
Yeah, sure. Al asked.
John Storm House is a historical location in East Fishkill, New York, near where we live. And as part of National Ghost Hunting Day, which we participated in on September 30th, we were looking for a historical place. And someone sent us a message saying they had an idea for us. And it was a home that had recently been bought by a young couple. And they are in the process of restoring it. And nobody in this area even knew it had existed. There was a portion of the house that goes back to 1750. And
wow.
It has a very interesting story connected
okay,
to
you,
it.
Can you stop there? Because
try and stop me.
Back there, you can talk about the history, but now let me get to my part.
Oh, geez.
Okay.
Oh, good.
Yes.
Can't we tell the story about the house itself?
Yeah.
Yeah, in a way, yes, but I want to tell you what happened.
Well, the story connects to a real-life event that took place during the Revolutionary War. The people that lived in the house were the Storm family. They go back six generations. And the British Tories had come in and raided the house and then took the owner up into a room in the attic, and they hung him, only for the bravery of one of his slaves was he cut down and his life was saved. Now, this true story seems to have impacted that house with some residual energy. I mean, there's layers of energy throughout the years, but this particular story had a connection with the woman who now owns the home. And now I'll let you take over, Twist.
Well, you already told the story already, so you ruined it.
Well, you talk about what happened.
All right, well, she ruined the beginning. What happened was, when we started coming up to introduce ourselves, the guy came up, and I looked at the part of the building, which I didn't know it was the original building. It's like split in half. One part was the original, the other part was built in 1800s. But the actual part of the building, I felt a sensation of sadness. Something occurred there. I didn't know anything about the history of the building. So, therefore, when we walked through the building itself, I had like a sadness. I walked upstairs. I had a sadness. Something happened in this building. I don't know what it was, but it went through me. And then from there, we abducted to her to tell us the story about there was a guy that hung. But I don't know if there was definitely something in that room. It was a room that we investigated in, and it was very emotional. I mean, Johnny can tell the rest, but go ahead.
Well, basically, during the National Ghost Hunting Day, there was a procedure to follow. This was laid out by Brian Cano.
Mm-hmm.
And the first hour of the investigation was minus all technology. There was no equipment to be used. We were able to video, but we couldn't use any of the REM pod sensors of any kind. Okay. We were just to get a feeling for the place we were in, to notice what was going on. It was very difficult. We have gotten so used to using this equipment mm-hmm. that sometimes you're not as focused on your senses right. as you should be.
Yeah.
So it kind of brought us back to square one.
Mm-hmm.
We also had to ask some questions. And everybody around the world who was participating in this event was asking the same questions at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
You also had to have participating a skeptic, a scientist, and a psychic,
uh-huh.
which we did. And some of the questions were, to the spirits, how would you like to communicate with us? And our psychic got the answer, trust what we feel and know. And then it was, how do we look to you? And the psychic received the answer, we appear as pillars of light connected to a main source that we emanate from.
Uh-huh.
So during that first hour, we noticed things like the room got cold. We have one investigator who has this odd sensation of popping in her ears when there's spirit activity. And her ears were popping. Other people felt tension, sadness, pressure in their head, a metallic taste in their mouth. Tom was emotional as he recalled his first visit to the house, which he just described. There was also a very strong smell of tobacco, cigar smoke.
Well, I don't know about that. Let's not go there.
Well, that was upstairs.
I know. I don't want to go there. I don't want to go there.
Okay.
I don't want to go there.
The psychic also said he felt death or a near-death connection to the land.
Yeah.
The empaths envisioned a black woman with a head wrap.
Mm.
That was the first hour. The second hour, we were then allowed to use some of the devices. So we set up a laser grid. We had a REM pod, periscope 360, a couple of K2s. And we invited the lady of the house to join us. And that's where things
now,
got interesting.
Now, pay attention when she tells you the story. It's a very interesting story. It's like a personal case that you're doing.
Oh, I'm listening.
Yeah, because this gets very interesting, because what I felt when I first got there, she didn't feel anything until that day. I don't know what went through her, but it went through her, and it went through her very heavy.
This back bedroom, which was up a back staircase, the lady of the house had said that the only thing she ever felt was in that area. And she also had a niece from England that was staying with her for a while, and she didn't want to sleep in that guest bedroom.
Yeah.
We found out later on that her mother also told her that she didn't want to scare her, but she hated that room.
She wasn't even a ghost hunter. She felt her bad vibes there, too.
That's exactly right.
I'm telling you.
Interestingly enough, we were getting just about a zero read on the EMF meters.
Yeah.
Until we went up those stairs into the hallway and approached that room.
Yeah.
And the investigator who was recording EMF temperature hour by hour, at that point, the EMF reading jumped to 2.8.
That's
as we approached that room. But it was the only reading we had throughout the night.
Yeah.
Also, the temperature dropped. It went from 79 to about 68. Well, anyway, we're in that guest room, and we have the psychic, his name is Sacred Owl, ask the first question, and immediately the REM pod alarms. Then the shadow detector has a radiating scheme of colors, and that went off. Al, who you just spoke about, Big Al there, felt a touch on his arm, and he experienced a static reaction.
You know what's the amazing part about that? Sacred Owl did the EVP session, but he didn't follow the sheet. And then when I said follow the sheet, because nothing was happening.
Mm-hmm.
Then I said follow the sheet.
The questions.
The questions on the sheet. Mm-hmm. And boom, that's when everything started hitting.
It was though those spirits suddenly tuned in to what we were doing.
Right. I mean, that was weird.
Well, what happened then was really surprising to all of us. And there must have been about 8-10 people in the room at the time. And the lady of the house, her name was Erin. Erin started to cry.
She got emotional. Well, the spirit was on her.
She was holding a K2, and all of a sudden it alarmed to red.
Yeah.
She told us she was hearing the words, come to me.
Yeah.
Okay.
One of the investigators felt a touch on the back of her neck, and another one got chills. Erin stops crying for a minute and says the feeling's gone away. But a moment later, the K2 is again alarming wildly, and Erin is sobbing.
Mm.
She said she felt as though she was standing at a gravesite, and she felt very sad, and she felt something beckoning her that she didn't want to leave.
Mm.
So one of the other investigators, Ron Iacovetti, was standing at the opposite end of the room. He brings over his K2, which had been quiet. As soon as he brings it over to Erin, it also starts alarming to red. The periscope 360 is flashing. We just never saw so much activity centered around a person. Usually it might be an area, but this is just around Erin.
It was like a vortex. That's basically what it was. It was between me, the woman, we both were sitting next to each other, and my medium. It was like a vortex. It was like going through, coming in and out, in and out, in and out. And every time something heavy came, she started getting emotional.
Sacred Owl, the psychic, asked, was Erin your daughter? He was trying to find a connection, maybe to the Storm family member who was hung in that attic.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, was Erin your daughter? Again, everything started to alarm. Erin, at this point, just collapsed on the bed, the team trying to comfort her. I think what was most remarkable is we had never seen a person connect with a spirit the way she did that night. Whether it was some reason that she was meant to buy that house, whether she really did have a connection to a previous owner, no one really knows. But
well,
those are possibilities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're done with that.
Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. Yeah,
it sounds like it's pretty wild.
Yeah.
The last hour of the night, we went down to the basement, and this time we wanted to bring the gentleman, her husband, into the investigation. His name is Andy. And while we're down in the basement, they're using the Echo Vox and the portal. And the first question was, do you want to talk to Andy? And the Echo Vox came back with yes. And then the next question was, who is here? And we got an odd name, Theo. And it said, we asked, can you say Andy? And the response was the French for yes, oui. I don't know where the French connection came in. And then it was, do you want Andy to know anything? And the response was oui. The problem became, though, that things quieted down once Andy came in. Now, Andy is from the UK. It was the Tories that hung the Storm family member in the attic. It almost seemed as though you could put together the idea that they were not as open to Andy as they had been to Erin.
He has a strong accent, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would believe he didn't like Andy. I can say that.
I don't know, because the last thing that happened in that room before we left it was we heard something that sounded like a growling noise.
Yeah, they didn't like
at
Andy, that's all.
At that point, we all packed up everything and left that room.
That's a wrap.
Does it sound like a monster type, typical monster noise or what?
Nah, it's just a growling.
A low growl.
I don't know.
Which was heard, wasn't on an EVP that we had heard, but it was something we heard with our ears, yeah. A few of us anyway.
Whatever.
It was a very interesting and different kind of an investigation.
Yeah.
Right.
All right, let's move on to the next one, because you're already on 10:30 already.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we already talked enough about John Stormhouse. All right. What do you want to do next? Want me to go down the line?
You can go right down the line. That's
okay.
Just fine
we'll
with
talk
me.
About the greatest Farnsworth in Gettysburg. We were there New Year's Eve day, and we were coming from my daughter's house, and we wanted to stop in Gettysburg, and this is the first time us being at Gettysburg. Everybody's been there 20 million times, and I haven't. So I said, you know what, if I'm going to go there, I'm going to stay. I told John, let's book the most haunted place in Gettysburg. So we found Farnsworth. And you can tell the beginning story, because the beginning story is your story, John. So why don't you tell that story?
Yeah, well, the best part about it was, when you get to be in a place that's supposedly haunted by yourselves, that's a real treat for a ghost hunter.
Yeah.
We didn't know this would happen, but I guess New Year's Day, it was snowing. Nobody else was in the whole place.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And right from the time that we started to set up, strange things began to happen. Tom took our dog out for a walk, and while he was out, I heard this loud crash that seemed to be coming from the floor, and it sounded like a cannon. Now, we all know in Gettysburg there's a lot of residual activity, so that's what I assumed it was,
yep.
But not knowing whether it had actually been the boiler in the basement that was blowing up, I called him on my cell phone, get back here right away.
Ready to freaking pack it up and leave. I said, oh, my Lord, what kind of investigator are you?
Then as he set up his equipment, I was starting to take a picture of him, and for the first time in my life, I actually saw a blue-white orb with my own eyes traveled from his foot up through his shoulder. I was so dumbfounded, I never even got a chance to take a picture of it.
Wow. That had to be amazing. That had to be absolutely amazing.
It really was.
I'm going to tell you something. First off, with the cannon part, I'm really amazed with the cannon part. We actually caught it on a recorder. I actually still have it.
Mm-hmm.
But what the amazing part about it is, in that particular room, other people has caught and stuff. The same type of evidence.
Mm-hmm.
That's the amazing part.
Yeah. And then we kept hearing footsteps. Now, we knew there was no one else in the building, but I kept sending Tom outside the door, downstairs, please keep checking. Maybe somebody else came in. I even made him take his boots and go out in the hallway and sort of pound on the floor, but it didn't sound the same as the footsteps we were hearing because it was carpeted out in the hallway.
Okay, now there's a trick to that now. You want me to tell that part?
Sure.
Yeah, let me tell you that part. What it was, when we first heard footsteps coming in the room, we were both looking at each other. Are you serious? We never even experienced anything like that before. Ghost hunting. I mean, just the actual footsteps were coming right out. I'm saying, hello. And you know what the funny part about it is? None of my REM pods went off. Not at all. And it was directly by the door. I had all my toys lined up straight. And all the way through my DVR was set. None of that went off. Not one.
But when the footsteps actually started to enter the room, we were on the bed. And I just grabbed onto him because the footsteps sounded like they were getting closer and closer to us.
Yeah, but there was a trick to it. The grandfather clock was in the hallway on the steps. It's a famous grandfather clock. I don't know how old it is, but it needed to be fixed because the time was off. It was like going off 10 minutes, 15 minutes, a half hour, 40 minutes. That's all it was doing.
Oh, yeah.
Every time,
I remember.
Yeah. You remember that? And every time
the bell
rang, the footsteps came in the room. I said, what? Are you kidding? And I was actually timing this stuff. Literally timing this stuff.
Every time it came through.
He's busy timing it, and meantime these footsteps are getting closer to the bed. Eventually, we both couldn't believe it. The bed actually started to move a bit.
Yeah, he juggled the bed.
The dog had been sleeping at the bottom of the bed, and all of a sudden he woke up.
He woke up to
it. What the heck is going on?
Yeah, it was a very active room.
You actually saw something sit on the bed.
No, we didn't see anything.
No, we heard and
we felt the bed moving.
Because
I at first said to Tom, do you feel that? The bed is moving. He's like, yeah, I do.
I jumped out of the bed and I started EVP in the bathroom everywhere.
He started asking, who's here?
Oh,
what
my
is
Lord.
It? The part, though, that he never told me about until the next morning, probably because he didn't want to scare me further, was that he had actually, when he sat up, saw an apparition of a woman that looked like a Civil War nurse. She had a cape on, right? She had her hair piled up on her head with a hat.
A bun, and she had a hat. Right. It was gray, too. It was actually gray.
Yeah. And the next day, when we finally saw the manager of the inn and told him what had happened, he said to us, oh, you saw Mary.
Yeah.
And we were like, Mary, this is somebody you know?
Yeah.
He says, yeah, everybody who stays in that room just about reports that this nurse is there taking care of people. She will stroke their hair.
Yeah.
She will sit on the bed. They'll see an indentation on the bed.
Yeah, it's weird. But, you know, it's very, you know, and it's not the science end, but the theory end, that actually we believe that it repeats back then. And it repeats back what they did back then.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was the amazing part. Because, you know...
It's residual.
Go ahead. Yeah, the residuals. But, you know, it's like maybe we're hearing footsteps coming through because maybe there's injured soldiers. Because there used to be an operating room in there. All of those rooms in that hotel is all operating rooms. You had sharpshooters up on the attic. You know, they were dying left and right. And, you know, you're hearing bodies probably being carried downstairs. I mean, you know, it was basically, we must have just experienced the Holy Grail on that avenue.
Yeah, up in the attic, as sharpshooters were leaning out the window, they would get shot, and then they'd just take their bodies and pile them up in a pile in the corner of the room.
It's crazy.
That building just has so much history to it. In fact, they believe that the shot that killed Jenny Wade came from that attic window at the Farnsworth Inn.
I mean,
for anybody who wants to go there, make sure you ask the Sarah Black Room.
Sarah Black Room.
That's a cool place.
It is. Definitely it is. But, you know, the amazing part about it is there used to be an operating room, but they used to have bones and legs and arms all the way up to the fourth floor.
Well, they said when they piled up too high, they just tossed them out the window.
Yeah. I mean,
really? They just threw them out the window?
Threw them out the window, yeah.
No wonder there's so much energy there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Well, Al wants to know, but I was going to ask you, do you have anything attached to you sometimes and come home with you?
No, I only did that once.
Mm-hmm.
And it was my stupidity, but, you know, I had to do it because I was doing a TV show for the Ghost Detective. So I had to do a preliminary sweep through, and I did it alone. And I experienced something that was incredible. But to be honest with you, it was probably one of the amazingest things I saw. What it was residuals that was coming back and forth from the upstairs to the downstairs. And I was downstairs, and I heard footsteps coming in, and all of a sudden I hear more footsteps coming downstairs, getting closer, getting closer. All of a sudden I hear the door slam. And I said, okay, this is enough. I'm starting to pack up. I'm done. So I go home. All of a sudden, I'm ready to sleep. All of a sudden, I basically looked in the corner of my eye, and the guy is standing on the corner by the door, looking at me. Okay, what are you guys doing? And to tell you the truth, it startled me for a bit. But I just think that he came to my house to check out what the hell am I doing here.
And hey, he disappeared after that. And he never came back.
Well, you had that situation where you saw that shadow person a number of times after that.
No, I only saw him once.
Oh, okay.
No, that wasn't that one. No, that was the beginning of when I first started ghost hunting. Before I even started ghost hunting. No, that was the thing I was waking up. No, that was totally different.
Yeah,
that ghost just stayed. I guess he just wanted to know what the hell I'm doing over there.
We always say prayer to St. Michael before we start.
Mm-hmm.
Use the white light technique.
Yeah.
We do a closing prayer and a saging afterwards to be sure that we don't bring anything home.
Yeah.
Because that is something that I fear. We've been doing this for nearly 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And knock wood, we really haven't had any terrible experiences.
No, you know what? I don't believe in demons. You know what? Let the demon lovers believe in it. I don't believe in it. To be honest with you, that's my opinion. I just think there's some ghost that just wants to know who you are. And that's it. That's the bottom line.
We try to keep our vibrations high. We are very positive with our investigations.
Oh, absolutely.
And we're really not looking for anything that is negative.
If you go into something like that with being in a negative space in the first place,
mm-hmm.
then you're going to attract negativity. And it will.
You
got to
be,
be
positive.
You got to be positive, because if you're not, it's going to cause you problems. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's going to cause you mental problems because your mind is running a mile a minute. I mean, I'll be honest with you. If you're doing this business, don't do it. If you're going to be nervous, don't do it. That's how I'm going to look at it.
Yeah.
That's bottom line. You know,
you really
open it up to yourself to go in a nut house.
We really feel that even with team members, we care about their health, we care about their emotional and their physical well-being, and we don't take them to places that are dangerous. If we are in a place where we're concerned about the air, Tom has everybody wear filter masks.
I usually don't go in places like that, but if I had to go in a place like that, then I would have to. But I normally 9 out of 10 don't go in places like that.
Well, yeah, you got to think about your health.
Yeah, health is more important than stupid ghost hunting. I'll really be honest with you. I'll really be honest with you, man. I mean, I love ghost hunting, but, you know, it comes to a point where, hey, you know, fame is fame, but you know what? No, that's not for me.
Just looking for truth, not fame.
Yeah, there you go. But a lot of people like doing that because they want to be TV people, but, you know, that's another issue. But
so,
other than that.
Do you got it?
Anything else you want to talk about?
Yeah.
We talked about Gettysburg.
So what other kind of cool stuff you want to tell me about?
Well, I think the favorite thing that we like to do is when we can do an investigation for a longer period of time.
Oh, okay. You want to talk about that one?
Yeah, we did a place called the Van Wyck Homestead.
You said it right.
Yeah, I did.
Oh, congratulations.
It's in Fishkill, New York. And it's part of what was a very large encampment during the Revolutionary War. They used it as a supply depot. And we at first had gotten permission to investigate. And the head of the Historical Society, when we came in, said he'd be in his office if we needed him. And it's always our policy when we go somewhere to ask the owner of the place, the administrator, whoever, to join us. Because our feeling is that the spirits are more familiar with them than they are with us. So we asked him to join us, and he seemed a little surprised and certainly was somewhat skeptical. But it was interesting how, after the first investigation, we were invited back and then back again, and he got more and more involved with what was going on.
Which was very cute, you know, because he was a skeptic. Because an old team was in there, and they did it private, and he didn't like that because he thought that they were faking it, the evidence.
Yeah, he never thought too much about the investigation prior to ours because he didn't witness it. And
well,
he
you know,
thought what they told him was
professionals
phony.
Doing this. You know, to be honest with you, their professionalism is we're kind, we're nice, we treat our customers with a grain of salt of everything that we can give them to our evidence,
to anything that, you know, we can help the customers out. But go ahead, John.
Well, we learned a lot during the 3 months that we were there, and Tom had a fabulous idea. He works at West Point, and his thought was, this is a place where there are unmarked graves of almost 100 Revolutionary War soldiers that they've identified through ground detection. Anyway, he got the idea of bringing West Point soldiers over to Fishkill with us.
Okay, now stop there.
Yep.
Now remember, there were reefs there.
It was Christmas time.
Right, all right. Yep. Now remember, there were reefs there. And you can tell the story with the reefs. Go ahead.
Yeah, he brought the soldiers, and they participated in the EVP sessions that we did. But the most striking part of it was, at the end, he had them stand outside where the reefs were marking these graves, and he had them salute. In fact, they had the trumpeter play taps.
Yeah, they honored what they did. Is they did a military honor. For not for military, because they weren't in dress and uniform, but they still did a military honor salute. It was very nice.
And we really had our best results of the 3 months with those soldiers there. We had them go around the room, and they each asked questions. It was really nice.
Yes, it was. And everything was on command. All my light toys, they all went off command. And they were amazed. Questions, they were going on command. We were downstairs. The most activity was downstairs and a little bit upstairs. But downstairs was rocking. I mean, it was like fireworks. I mean, literally, the guy who takes care of the place, that he's not a skeptic anymore, but he actually went upstairs. I had one of my techs upstairs on the DVR watching it, and he went upstairs and asked him, "You got a button you're turning on these equipment?" I mean, to be honest, I was even amazed. I was even amazed because how much the activity. Because what I believe, what was in that place was a French soldier that died there, and as a French soldier knew, must have sensed that these guys were soldiers because they saluted. They saluted inside the house. They saluted outside the house. You know, it was.
The admin, the historical society guy, when we began to think that this was a French soldier, he actually again ran upstairs to get the name of the latest soldier they had identified, and it, sure enough, it was someone with a French-sounding name.
Mm-hmm.
We were in the basement, and there's a dirt floor there. Yeah. Whenever you can get down to the dirt, that is really crucial because you're getting a feel for what went on there so many years ago. Mm-hmm. And there's all fencing because that used to be used in the wintertime. They would bring the animals in. They would have some of the soldiers down there that were injured. And all of our equipment turned itself off down in that basement.
Oh, God. It was fireworks.
The guy on the camera just could not believe what was going on.
No.
His camera was gone. Tom's video camera was gone.
Oh.
Yeah, the REM pod. Nothing would work.
Work? What are you talking about? What are you talking about?
Down in the basement.
No, that was the first investigation. This is the second one. It was lighting up like fireworks.
Yeah. Yeah, but we did have one where nothing worked.
Yeah, that's a different investigation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, well, Brian asks, Brian Baldwin. Baldwin.
Okay.
In the chat, he asks about the one piece of equipment that is a must-have.
A must-have, okay. Oh, must-have on an investigation?
Yeah.
Okay, we probably don't agree, so you go first, Tom. What's your must-have? What piece of equipment do you like best?
What I like best? Actually, a recorder. I mean, it's old-fashioned, but a recorder and a sensitive, like a REM pod, so you can detect if any EMF field readings.
Yeah, the REM pod is actually a good sensor because something has to really go up to that antenna to make it go off.
Mm-hmm.
It's not so much the circumference like it is with other sensors. It's actually the antenna.
Yeah, but some of the sensitive equipment is too sensitive and it's garbage.
Yeah. I think that we're still old-fashioned in the sense that even though we use this equipment, mm-hmm. doing an EVP is really the heart of what we're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
It's real information. The people that do the analysis are so used to how we breathe,
mm-hmm.
how we our stomachs sound. They
yep.
can sort all of that out. And when you get a good EVP, mm-hmm. that's the closest you're going to get
yeah.
to believe that there really are spirits that linger in this world.
Absolutely.
That's the way I've always thought about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me just say there's just one investigation that stands out in my mind. We don't really do home investigations. We give a lot of advice on our Facebook page when people private message us, and they
That's
do a lot.
That's what I was going to ask you, is if you did home investigations.
We did one.
No,
we're
really
one.
Most interested in historical locations.
Yeah.
I think home investigations are an accident waiting to happen.
Yeah.
You're dealing with too many different kinds of people.
Mm-hmm.
You're stepping into such situations that are really more than we're equipped to handle.
Mm-hmm.
You
a
never
of,
know when there
of
might
investigators,
be mental illness.
A lot of investigators tell me the very same thing.
Yeah.
And I have
well,
to
you know,
agree.
You wait for a lawsuit.
Yeah.
Be honest with you, if you tangle with somebody that you're scaring the shit out of them, you're waiting for a lawsuit. I'll be honest with you. I mean, to me, I don't think you're out there. Because every time we do an investigation, you know, people do investigate. Oh, you got 20 demons in here. You know, you're scaring the shit out of people.
Well there's
I think
a case.
The thing is,
I'm sorry. Yeah, I disagree with that.
There's a
we
case
do
want
to help people.
There's a case here in town where these kids took this paranormal class. It took
mm-hmm.
us, which was like 6 weeks or something like that,
mm-hmm.
once a week.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And now
right.
they think they're paranormal investigators. And
mm-hmm.
they
yeah.
Scared the hell out of one family so badly that
this
family moved out of their
oh,
house.
Are you serious?
I am dead serious with you.
Oh, my Lord.
And yeah, the same kid decided he wanted to be on my show last week.
Oh,
and,
my Lord.
And then I found out
wow.
all about what happened and things like that. He will not be on my show.
Don't advertise that. Don't advertise that.
What we will do is people who will write to us to tell us about odd things in their homes, we always advise them to start that day with a diary.
Oh, absolutely.
What happened, the date, the time, the weather,
mm-hmm.
who else witnessed it, and
yeah.
to keep that diary for 2 weeks and call us back.
Right.
And you'd be surprised
mm-hmm.
how often, if they do call
Not
back,
they never
and many
call
times
back.
They don't.
They don't call back.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Then we'll talk to them by phone.
Yeah. I mean, if they wanted literature of what's going on here, I would give them literature. Do an investigation, do literature, and that's it. That's bottom line.
And then we'd recommend them, and we have done this in very few cases, but we do have friends in the paranormal that do home investigations.
Yeah, they do.
And we'll refer them to them,
yeah.
people we trust.
Calm down.
We're
Calm
very
down.
Lucky. We really have hooked ourselves up with some wonderful other investigators
mm-hmm.
who are always around to help.
Mm-hmm.
We have photographers that will look at photographs
mm-hmm.
that we get.
Yep.
To you know, debunk them to see if there are things that are natural in the
mm-hmm.
environment, light
yep.
refraction
mm-hmm. yep.
and such.
Yep.
So we stay within what we know.
So I just
yeah.
want to tell you on this last investigation we did, Van Wick, we didn't tell you what kind of EVP we got. We got Mark. Mark is a I believe that it was Marquis Lafayette, and Marquis Lafayette was there. So, I mean that's pretty cool. I mean, to get an EVP, clear EVP, a
yes,
class A
is.
EVP.
It's very
My
nice.
My favorite EVP was
yeah.
the one home investigation we did
yeah.
where the woman wanted us to go to prove to her family that she wasn't crazy, that it was her dead fiancé who was
yeah.
there in the house. And we got an EVP that said,
I love
clear
you.
As a bell,
I love you. I love you.
Oh, wow.
Which it was an emotional case. It was 3 months investigation there. It was a long investigation. I was actually going to put that on TV on that one because I was going to put it on like a Lifetime type of thing because it was emotional. It was a guy that was very well known in the area. He was a race. He races boats, and he died on his boat. So, I mean, it was very emotional. It was very good investigation. EVPs were crazy. I mean, you know. But, you know, it was good. It was a good investigation. But that's all I'd done. I didn't really do much of housing. Yeah.
So, tell us again how, before you, it's getting that time, so let tell us how to find you again and all that kind of happy stuff.
Okay.
You know, your
websites. Well, if you're in our area, just
Can I tell you one more investigation?
real quick, we got...
Okay. We did one at my Beacon High School, and just did that, we just got done with it last week. And this investigation was very interesting. The reason why it was interesting was it was connected to me. And I didn't know it at all until I got information that a person that I went to school with, she says, "Wow, you said the theater? Wow, I know who the ghost is." Because the ghost was it was going through me. And we had when we were doing the investigation, there was a portal. And the portal was going through me, and it's in the middle of the stage, and I was mostly going crazy with that one, and also the actual investigation was a person committed suicide. He belonged to the theater there, and we felt that he was part of that because he actually said his name. And also the person that was with friends of his also he had a nickname, so it was two nicknames. You remember the nicknames, Jonna?
Well, I don't think it matters. We did get the name of the person who did the murder-suicide. It was in the New York Times in 1978.
Oh, God.
But just to wrap up here, we are Ghost Magnets with a Twist on Facebook. Our website is listed under the About section, and our next meetup, for anybody who'd like to join us, is in this area, the Hudson Valley, is December 11th at the I-84 Diner, and it's our holiday celebration. And we're so happy to have been able to be part of your program,
definitely.
Arizona. Thank you for
the
invite.
Oh, well, thank you for being, thank you for coming on, and, you know, even that it's, you know, Thanksgiving, and hang out, and I'll talk to you for a minute after the show. But you guys, everybody, thank you for showing up tonight. I do appreciate it. You guys have a good Thanksgiving, a happy Thanksgiving, a smooth Thanksgiving, and don't let the ghosts bug you too much. Everybody stay warm, stay safe, and until next week, I will see you. Bye.
Happy.
I never thought to be called back to a home that I summer's gone, the call is strong, and there's something I must do. Thought I knew all of the stories that a southern girl could know. But there's a dream of Mississippi that I never tell a soul. There's a boy there with his arms outstretched.